Dominated by the wild, terrible figure of Heathcliff and infused with much of the bleak beauty of its setting, the Yorkshire Moors, Wuthering Heights is one of the most highly imaginative novels in the English language.
Over much of Wuthering Heights, there broods a horror of great darkness.
Starving and homeless, and as good as dumb in the streets of Liverpool. I picked it up and inquired for its owner. Not a soul knew to who it belonged. He is strong yet, even without food. Bears a certain likeness to my first that died. We shall call him Heathcliff.
The Lord be with us.
I shall tell how you boasted that you would turn me outdoors as soon as the master died. See whether he will not turn you out directly.
At the end of the day, Heathcliff, the gypsy, is the favoured son in many ways.
Kathy was much too fond of Heathcliff. The greatest punishment we could invent for her was to keep her separate from him.
So this is young, very young Kathy and very young Heathcliff. Who played the sing the love duet, the two heroes of the opera, but they were still children. So she's going and, you know, this little gypsy boy who's been abandoned and he's taking this to this very educated English family, and she's teaching him, she likes him, and she's teaching him to read, because they cannot read. So she's teaching him a poem, and he's trying to learn it, and then at the end they sing it together, and then they start promising each other to love each other, etc.
They're creatures who relish the wild freedom of the moor, its beauty, its strength, the winds. It is the essence of their existence.
Father was an emperor of China, and your mother, an Indian queen.
I know the land you write of, only...
Let us be reckless on the moor. You are not like anyone. You are royal.
Then you must be my wild princess.
And you must be my savage prince.
Then I'll give you gifts like no
I
Cathy and Heathcliff go from the world below of Wuthering Heights to reach the crag, which serves as their private castle, their escape. The movement is about two souls, free together on the moor, free from hate and social convention. They fantasize about their castle and ruling it.
They are captivated with
each other first as children, and then as lovers. They promise never to forsake the moor, their freedom, or most importantly, their love. Love duet.
The laugh of Cathy and Heathcliff is not comfortable, tame, or secure. It is like the moor wind, wild, free, strong, and finally
destructive.
Gypsy out of my sight.
Hindley, whip in hand, strides unevenly to Heathcliff in filthy labourer's garb.
All in a shadow, back to the shadow.
Hindley whips and kicks Heathcliff.
Revolt!
The whipping arm.
Repulse!
The whip cracks. Hindley staggers in his drunkenness,
resist,
delivering a less than skillful beating.
Retaliate! Enrage! And if you escape to the moor again, I shall bolt.
And so it all goes back to childhood and Hindley.
Ends, and then Edgar sees Cathy, and then he falls in love. He doesn't fall in love like, you know, an English gentleman falling in love.
A fancy face,
Linton is an example of constancy and tenderness. Kathy is destitute of a certain strange beauty in her fierceness or of honesty in the midst of perverted passion and passionate perversity. I nicknamed the aria where Kathy tells Nellie a secret that she's thinking about marrying Edgar, Kathy's decision.
This is my secret. I know what I do is wrong.
She has fate in her hands at that moment where she can admit her true love and follow it, or she can decide to go with a more conventional way of living, which of course is Edgar, representing wealth, social status, a complete denial of her spirit and her soul. That launches Heathcliff into his torment and his never-ending revenge, really.
Whatever it takes, one thing to mind.
Kathy is a very wild, flamboyant sort of woman that you would fall in love with if you were a Heathcliff. I picture Kathy as an unearthly person. When she's beautiful and brilliant, she's ethereal. And when she's angry or upset, she's fiery. She's very strong, independent, smart, but also impulsive and destructive with her impulses.
They all die.
They are in the living room. Kathy is playing the harpsichord and she's bored.
Who is it, Nelly?
You recollect him, sir? The one who used to live in my master Earnshaw's house? Heathcliff. He's come back.
The gypsy ploughboy?
Beat him up, Nelly, please.
It's Heathcliff, he's back. And that's his theme. And then when this music arrives, he opens the door and he comes as a full gypsy dress. He's very rich, he has a lot of money. He comes after many years. So he says...
does become a complete wastrel and a drunkard.
He sort of spins out of control. He does miss his wife. He wants to be kind of normalized within the society, but it all goes horribly wrong. And it's easy to understand how he could blame the gypsy as the outsider who's caused it all. And
he knows in his mind at that point that he's losing everything through his gambling and drinking.
He's in a tavern, chatting and flirting with wenches and getting bawdy and plotting how to defeat the gypsy. Delirium aria.
Saved you from losing it.
You robbed me of it.
I am your angel. I have saved you and the heights as you once let me in. I allow you to stay. You may live as you please. So drink, enjoy your life of ease.
I will kill you first. Death to the devil.
Joseph, rid my house of these dregs. Put their pathetic leader to bed.
but not in the master's room.
You have it in your power to be Linton's brother.
You have treated me infernally. If you fancy I'll suffer unrevenged, I'll convince you of the contrary. With your sister's secret, I'll make the most of it. Stand yourself.
Presence here is a moral poison. I shall deny you hereafter admission into this house.
Here is not happy because that's why the music is different, because he's coming here and says, what are you doing here? You know, get out of my house. Tenor talking to another tenor. So
I wish you the joy of the milk-blooded coward, since that is what you have preferred to me. Answer my question. Will you give up Heathcliff, or will you give up me? I absolutely require that you choose.
Don't you see I scarcely stand? Edgar, you leave me now!
Nelly, let me finish.
Within this literary world of proprietary and bonnets and behaving, there's a book about violence and passion and madness, which is very gripping.
Heathcliff, he is an explosive, dark hero that you're drawn to.
Oh.
gone to church, madame. Something.
Heathcliff enters. With a stride or two, he sweeps Kathy in his arms. This is the final reuniting of the lovers, and they both seem to recognize Kathy's death is imminent. They neither speak nor loosen their embrace for a period.
Kathy, my life.
Kathy's death is imminent. Heathcliff covers Kathy with kisses.
Why should not yours suffer?
He mumbles in utter despair at her condition.
Don't torture me as you are dying, branding your words on my memory. Beating deeper after you die, I have not killed you. That is a lie.
There's something about the passion between the two characters that everybody responds to.
If I have done wrong, for it I am dying, I'm not going to live. Let me alone. Forgive. Let me alone.
Heathcliff reluctantly hands over the collapsed Kathy to Edgar and Nellie. It is a very tense and sad music, with Heathcliff's forced exit. Music 18F prepares for aria as set changes to Moore. Heathcliff moves crazily through the storm to the stone crag, once the kingdom of Kathy and himself. Music 19, Heathcliff's aria.
Stop that crying. Put your kerchiefs away. She wants none of your tears, for each thought she had of him. A thousand to me. My Lord more in one day than he could in 8 years. Damnation to you.
I see how people could read into it how incredibly abusive and dark this character is. I mean, he spends much of the book after Kathy's death doing basically horrible things to people, but I still had a compassion for him.
I curse that I am strong, living endless wrong. I can't live without my song. I can't live without my life. Meet me in the moor high above. In our kingdom we belong there, where no devils, gods or men can stand between us.
I can't find
find you in this nightmare. Meet me in the moor high above, where no devils, gods, or men can stand between us.
The intensity that he feels things speaks to how much he is consumed by himself and his desire for the here and now. And his passion for Kathy comes out of that.
Two generations, and I decided to tackle the second generation. Basically, in the operatic form in the musical theater of Wuthering Heights, it normally stops when Kathy dies. So I wanted to approach the second generation. I find them interesting, and I find them to be a redemption of sorts.
And when I return with your cousin, remember he will not be so strong and merry as you are, since he has lost his mother.
But I do want so much to have him like it here, and be close to me.
Mind my strict order that she must not wander from the Grange Park.
Yes, of course.
Still father is gone so seldom, and I should
are you familiar with this path?
My folk live near.
If you follow you, I'll show you secret thoughts. Winds are strong apart, but so am I.
But so am I.
my disappointment, Kathy. Compassion reigned a little while, finally shut from heaven's smile, finally shut from heaven's smile. The die is cast, the victim's held fast, my reach is vast, my role is recast. Years in a void, my sense as ice cold, revenge is cold, from forehead forward, when a man's soul turns back, then a man can.
I see Nelly as a young woman with a lot of emotion, yes, some wisdom, but also she doesn't have all the answers either.
She's sort of the soul of the family. She keeps everyone from completely falling apart.
Nelly Dean is a character of true benevolence and home fidelity.
bounds within my heart. Once the sun warmed my arms, now it burns within my soul. Once bird songs fell on my ears, now I hear strange inner tunes. If only you knew, if only you knew what lives inside of me, if only I had magic words, you would understand.
Thank you.
last disturb you finally, as you torture me incessantly. I will not allow him to rest at your side. I shall be put right next to you.
Here, Heathcliff is going on a grave, digs, takes the coffin, opens the coffin and grabs her. Why did you leave me? That's how the story is. Written in the beginning of the 19th century. And that is exactly the heart of the Gothic novel that's here.
Master Heathcliff, are you ill? His conscience has made his heart a hell.
If you strike me ever again, Hareton will strike you. He'll not obey you anymore.
Leave her alone. Strike me, not her!
Devil, I'll stand beside him.
The single link that connects Heathcliff with humanity is his rudely confessed regard for Hareton Earnshaw, the young man whom he has ruined.
It is a poor conclusion, is it not? An absurd termination to my violent exertion. Two houses demolished. Myself trained as Hercules. All in my power. I am him. My old enemies have not beaten me. Now would be the precise time to revenge myself on the young. I could finish it.
Heathcliff stands unredeemed, never once swerving in his arrow straight course.
Course to perdition.
About her I cannot speak, about him I cannot think, of the endless past they awaken. It brings no rest to me, it brings no hope to me, it brings no wish to knit my broken heart beneath. My only wish is to forget.
Whether he's a hero or an anti-hero, I think everybody responds to the tortured soul and wanting something beyond hope.
Heathcliff dies, and then a little music comes with a cello, with gypsy tunes, because he was a gypsy boy, so it's like his soul is going to heaven, and then you sing.
Heights sometimes?
Tis right to shut up the place for the use of such ghosts as choose to inhabit it.
The dead are at peace, Nelly.
And finally, those two fall in love. And they are the young, they are the children of the previous one. They fall in love and they finally go in the wild nature together. But it's very quiet because it's like after a big storm.
Locks to the past are broken open. Locks to the past are broken open. Sad pathways overgrown, a pit for us to roam.
It is a strange story with something of the vividness of a nightmare and something of the beauty of an old ballad.
Charlotte described Wuthering Heights simply. It is rustic all through. It is moorish and wild and knotty as the root of Heath.
About Heathcliff, Charlotte Bronte wrote, "Whether it is right or advisable to create beings like Heathcliff, I do not know. I scarcely think it is, but this I know, the writer who possesses the creative gift owns something of which he is not always master, something that at times strangely wills and works for itself."